We know that at church you can feel the peace, rest, and comfort that the Savior provides. We can promise you that as you come to church, you'll grow your relationship with God and deepen your relationship with His Son, Jesus Christ, and you'll have more peace and joy in your life. We'll see you then.
See you then.
Bye!
Oh Lord, my God, when I'm in awesome
Amen.
I'll meet you in that morning by the bright riverside, when all sorrows has drifted away. I'll be standing at the portals when the gates open wide, at the close of last long weary day. I'll meet you in the morning,
in the morning,
meet you in the morning,
with a
how do you do,
do you do,
how do you do.
Sabbath morning service here at One Accord Christian Service Movement. I trust and pray you had a good week and that God has woken you up energized and ready to worship and praise Him today on His holy day. I want to say good morning to Sister Veronica Qualls, Brother Wayne, and family out there in New Jersey. Sister Brenda Samuel, Brother Simba, good morning. Blessings to you both. Brother Garnet Patron and family, your wife, your children, your grandchildren down there in Trinidad, good morning to you. Dr. Cedric Hines and family down there in Atlanta, Georgia, good morning. Happy Sabbath. And Sister Avon Carr, good morning, beloved. To you, your children, your grandchildren out there in Maryland, God bless you. Happy Sabbath. And Sister Camelia Arthur, good morning to you. And that's who we have on YouTube so far. I see the numbers are growing slowly. And we trust and pray everybody can get here in a timely manner so we can all receive of God's word. And on Facebook, I want to say...
I'm sorry.
Good morning, beloved. I've got to turn down the volume. On Facebook, I want to say good morning to Sister Thea Charles, Sister Janice Niles, good morning, happy Sabbath. Sister Linda Archer Hislop, and there are some others there that I can't see, because I lost the phone this week, so I don't have the normal two phones so I could see from Facebook and YouTube. Brother Alan Samuel and your wife down there in St. Lucia, welcome, thanks for joining us. But we will make do, and by God's grace, we will have a wonderful day. This morning, we have with us in studio Sister Anisha Clark and her daughter. Amen. And Sister Anisha is going to be singing for us this morning. But before we do that, let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your blessings of the week. We thank you for bringing us to this day. We ask you, Lord, to bless this service. May it be a blessing to us. May it glorify your name. May everything be done decently and in order. And may the Wi-Fi work with power. And may everything that is done here be done with the power of your Holy Spirit and the authority of God the Father. Under the auspices of God the Son, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Okay, so this morning we'll be focused on two men cannot control the same house. We'll be focused on the abomination that brings about desolation. All right? And so I want you to tune your hearts in as Sister Anisha Clark is going to sing for us. And she's going to sing two songs for us today. So it is my trust and prayer that as she ministers to us in music, that God will minister to our hearts through the words of the song that she's sharing with us. Sister Clark.
Pleasant Sabbath to everyone. Sabbath. Okay. We're pilgrims on the journey of the narrow road, and those who've gone before us line the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary. Their lives were sparing testament to God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of weaknesses, let us run the race, not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us lift those behind us, the heritage of faithfulness, pass on through godly lives. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way, and the footprints that will lead them to believe, and the lies will live will inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Church, after all, our hopes and dreams have come and gone, and our children sift through all we've left behind. May the clue that they discover and the memories they uncover becomes the light that leads them to the road we each must find. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way, and may the footprints that will lead them to believe, and the have, lead them to believe that the life we'll live will inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Sister Clark. And I know you enjoyed it. I know you enjoyed it. And we will be hearing from Sister Clark again before we close this service out. And I want to say good morning to Sister Esther St. Louis and Brother Julius. Happy Sabbath, Brother Rudy Hines and family. Happy Sabbath to you. Brother Alexander Boyton, Brother Sugarman. Good morning, sir. Happy Sabbath to you. Sister Clarette Gabriel Lewis, good morning. Happy Sabbath to you. Sister Dr. Stephanie Bola Marshall. And Dr. Marshall, Pastor Marshall down there in Tennessee. Happy Sabbath to you both. Sister Clarette Gabriel Lewis, good morning. Happy Sabbath to you, beloved. Sister Leslie Leanne, good morning. Happy Sabbath. Thanks for joining us, beloved. And to all the others who haven't said anything, happy Sabbath and welcome to our Sabbath morning service. Brother Gerard Kelly, good morning, brother. Welcome. Hope you're doing well. To God be the glory. Nice to have you with us, brother. Blessings. Okay, so now we're going to have our prayer, and then we're going to go to the spoken word, and then we will be favored with another rendition by Sister Clark. All right, let us bow our heads for prayer. Dear Jesus, we thank you for your blessings of the week. We thank you for waking us up this morning in our right minds. We thank you for Jesus Christ, the one who sacrificed himself for us. Lord, we accept him and we believe on him and we walk after his spirit so that we may live and breathe and have our being, not now and here in this life, but in the life to come. We thank you for the plan of salvation so perfectly executed by the Godhead to ensure the salvation of mankind. And Lord, we recognize your effort on our behalf, and so we surrender to you so that you may have your way with us and in us, directing our steps and following implicitly as you lead. We thank you this morning for your goodness towards us, your provision on towards us, and your shelter and your protection, Lord. We go to and fro daily without thinking, but you protect us, you keep us, and you enable us. And we say thank you. We ask you to forgive us when we have sinned against you in a word, a thought, or an act. Separate us from those sins, cast them as far as the east is from the west, and remember them no more. Help us to forget. Help us to forgive ourselves. Help us to learn to forgive others, even as you forgive us. I pray, Lord, that you will enable us, Lord, to be our brother's keeper. If one of us be caught in a fault, may those who are around us that are spiritual restore us in the spirit of meekness, allowing your spirit to be their guide and stay, because we are our brother's keeper and we are as strong as our weakest link. So Lord, help us to be one in Jesus Christ, following the example he set, allowing the love of God to flow through us to others so that your name will be glorified and those who belong to you will be edified and cemented on the rock Christ Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for the word. You have placed your word in our hearts that we may not sin. And you have asked some of us to share it. And this morning, I am being obedient to your calling, to be your emissary, to share your word. We thank you for how you have blessed this ministry in the last 4 years and how you have enabled us to grow slowly from strength to strength. We pray, Lord, that we will continue to allow you to direct and to lead. Help us to be our brother's keeper in the regards that Jesus did. May we share not just your word, but the means that you provide us with in this ministry to help others so that they may come to know you through compassion and through the spoken word. I pray now as I get ready to share your word, Lord, hide me behind the cross. May Jesus Christ and him crucified be lifted up, because he has said in his word, and I, if I be lifted up, will draw all men unto me. So Jesus, as we lift you up today, through the power of the Spirit in me, draw, draw, draw to yourself, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Good morning, Sister Virgie Paul. Welcome. Sister Keturah Forbes, good morning, beloved. Thanks for joining us. And my army buddy from years gone by, Brother Garcia Jamont and Sister Pat Jamont and your daughter Felicia. I know she's a grown lady now. I don't know if she's still home with you or she's out on her way, but blessings to you all, man. Good to have you join us this morning. This morning, we'll be focused on the topic, Two Men Cannot Control the Same House, focusing on the abomination that causes desolation. Sister Angela Mahu, welcome, beloved. My big sister, love you. Thanks for joining us. All right. In the Bible, Jesus refers to the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet. And there are many schools of thought on it. And a lot of people, when referring to it, focus on the timelines. In my studies, the Spirit of God said to me, Silburn, don't focus on the timelines. Forget about the 2,300 days. Forget about the 70 weeks, because you can get that right and still have abominations within you. You can get all the arithmetic, all the historical data correct. But if I can't forgive you, then I'm in trouble. If I can't love you, then I would be a castaway with all that religious knowledge. Even the devils, all right, when they come to Jesus, tremble because they know he is the truth. But because there is no righteousness in them, they are vanquished. So we've got to put the effort and we've got to put things in its proper perspective. And so this morning we are endeavoring to do that using the Word of God. The Word of God is very clear. And so we're going to go to the Word. Now, I want you to understand something about the abomination that causes desolation. It is used in Scripture as a parable. I'm not saying it is a parable. I'm saying it is used as a parable. What is a parable? A parable is a simple story used to illustrate a moral or spiritual lesson. And we know Jesus told parables. They were not actual things that happened, but he used stories in this world that people could understand to transport them to a heavenly meaning and understanding, basically giving them the information he wants them to receive. All right? So, when we look at this, I want you to look at this in that light. Something that happens on earth in the natural that God is using to transport us to the spiritual. Okay? So now, let us find out what the word abomination means. Because, you know, a lot of times we read the Bible and we don't take time to get to understand some of the words that are read. Okay? So the word abomination means a thing that causes disgust or hatred. That's the first meaning. The second meaning is something that which is exceptionally loathsome, hateful, sinful, wicked, deceptive, and vile. What is an abomination? An abomination is something that is exceptionally loathsome, hateful, sinful, wicked, deceptive, and vile. Okay? So, let us take a look at what the Bible says abominations are. Turn with me in your Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. We're looking at what abominations are according to the Bible. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And we're going to read from verse 9 to 11. And we see abominations articulated there. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And let us read from verse 9. And the Bible says to us, "Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor adulterers, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revelers, or revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of us. But we are washed, but we are sanctified, but we are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus by the Spirit of our God." So, we got a list of abominations that the Bible warns us against. And he reminds us that we used to do these things, but we met Jesus. And he has called us. And he has justified us. And he has sanctified us by the Spirit of the living God. Let us look at some other abominations as stated in the Bible. Turn with me to Romans chapter 1, and we are going to read from verse 28 to 32. All right? In fact, we're going to read from 29 to 32, and then we'll go back to verse 28. Let's read from verse 29. Being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. So God is listing through Paul what abominations are. Now look at verse 28. Look at verse 28. We're talking about the abomination that causes desolation, that brings about destruction. Okay? It says in verse 28, and even as they did not retain God in their body temples, in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Brethren, these scriptures are going to clearly help us understand what the true meaning of the abomination of desolation is. All right? So, we understand what abomination is or what abominations are. What is desolation? What does desolation mean? What does desolation mean? A state of emptiness. To be desolate means to be empty. All right? The second meaning is a feeling of great unhappiness, hopelessness, loss, and void. Desolation. A state of emptiness, a feeling of great unhappiness, hopelessness, loss, and void. So abominations, sins and iniquities are stated in the Bible that will cause us to become greatly unhappy, will make sure that we are hopeless, and that we have lost something, so we are empty and void. Is that clear, brethren? Those are the meanings of the word. The abomination of desolation is a phrase from the Bible in the book of Daniel describing the pagan sacrifices with which the second century BC Greek emperor by the name of Antiochus Epiphanes replace the twice daily offerings in the Jewish temple of God with worship to idols. So God's name was glorified in a physical temple built with hands that the Jews worshipped in. When the Greeks took over, Aristarchus Epiphanes decided to remove the altars of God and place his pagan idols and worship them in what was once the temple of God. As a result, that temple had to be destroyed. So let us go to the Bible. Let's go to the Bible to see if what I'm saying is true. All right? It's not what Silburn said. It's what Silburn read. It's in the book. Join me. Let's take a look. So let's go to Matthew 24:15. Matthew 24 and verse 15. Jesus says something here to us. And Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. He came to seek and to save those of us that were lost. We were all lost. So when Jesus speaks, I listen because I want to stay saved. Everything Jesus says is of paramount importance to me. He's warning me. And he says to us in verse 15 of Matthew 24, when you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Whosoever readeth, let him understand. Jesus is appealing to us to gain understanding by his Spirit. He tells us his Spirit will teach us all things and bring it to our remembrance. He tells us his Spirit will guide us into all truth. He shall not speak of himself, but he will speak what Jesus tells him. Jesus is telling us, and the Spirit is willing and ready and is waiting for us to gain the understanding. In the name of Jesus, we pray. We will all get a clear understanding today by the power and the teaching of the Holy Spirit as he ministers through me to us all today. Okay? So, Jesus refers to Daniel. So, let's go to Daniel. Daniel 9, verse 25. Daniel 9, verse 25. All right? Jesus is referring to what Daniel said in Daniel 9, verse 25 to 27. And the Bible tells us there, "Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. And the street shall be built again and the wall in troublous times." So from the time God commissioned Nehemiah and Amos to rebuild the temple and to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, the Bible is telling us, and up until the time the Messiah comes, Jesus comes, from the time of the rebuilding to the time Jesus comes, all right, it's giving us a time period, all right, of 62 weeks. I'm not focused on that, brethren. It's happened already. I'm not a history teacher. I'm a preacher of the Word of God. My purpose here is so you can understand, so you are in the holy place when Jesus comes, as he commissions us in Matthew 24, verse 15. Sister Claudia Brett, good morning, beloved. Thanks for joining us. So I want to focus on what Jesus wants us to focus on. All right? He says here that it will be rebuilt in troublous times. Look at verse 26. "And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off." Jesus will be killed. He'll be cut off. He'll be executed. All right? "But not for himself." Jesus is not being executed because of something he did. He's executed because of something we did. Okay? I want us to understand. The Bible tells us to read and understand, brethren. Jesus says, let us get an understanding. So let's take our time. All right? "Messiah be cut off or killed, but not for himself. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." He was doing it for us. He was the perfect Lamb of God. We needed perfection to come die for us so that we could be restored to perfection. So we must get that very clear. It continues to say, "And the people of the prince," small p, "shall come," "and the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined." So that word prince there is not referring to Jesus, Prince of Peace. That word prince there is referring to the prince of this world. Okay? I think we understand that. Jesus says in John 14, 30, that he has to go because the prince of this world cometh and he has nothing in me. That's a powerful piece of scripture. By saying he has nothing in me, in fact, let's go to it. Keep your finger there. Keep your finger there. And let's go to John 14, 30. And it says, "Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh and has nothing in me." In other words, he said, my temple is clean. There are no abominations in there. There is nothing the prince of this world, the prince of sinners, the one who has caused this world to tremble at its foundation because of iniquity, has nothing in me. Does he have in me? Does he have in you? Because whatever he has in us is abomination. You see? So I want you to understand. I want to set the table here so we can clearly understand, brethren, and not miss it and lose our crown. Okay? So, we understand that Jesus comes, he's killed for our sins, and the prince and his people are going to bring about a destruction. That's what it says in verse 26 here. "And the people of the prince shall come, shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. Shall destroy. So the abomination of desolation brings about destruction. Okay? Want us to get that? Stick with me, brethren. Stick with me. Verse 27. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. And in the middle of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblations to cease. And for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate even until the consummation. And that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Check it out. In the middle of the week, the sacrifices shall cease. The oblations shall cease. Worship to God within the physical temple on earth is going to stop. That's what Aristarchus Epiphanes did in the natural. But there is a spiritual lesson that you need to get. And as a result, that temple was destroyed. You think I'm kidding you? Turn with me to Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24, and let's read verse 1 and 2. Let's read verse 1 and 2. Because of the abominations that took place in that temple, it was destroyed. And Jesus prophesied it. And Jesus went out, verse 20, chapter 24, verse 1 and 2, and departed from the temple. And his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. They wanted to show off their beautiful edifice. All right, what a wonderful temple it was and stuff. And Jesus said unto them, see not all this. Don't worry about this temple here. See ye not all these things. That is not the focus. The focus is not the 70 weeks. The focus is not the 2300 days. The focus is not the historical data and background. This is what you focus. Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon the other that shall not be thrown down. It's going to be destroyed. It's going to become rubble. It's going to become a pile of rocks. Don't focus on that. Don't focus on the natural. Don't focus on the historical information. Focus on your soul. Get the message of the parable, I'll dare say, of the abominations that cause desolation. That's what we need to get. Sister Donna, good morning. Brother Robert Lewis, good morning. Brother Richard Davis and Sister Denise Davis out there in California, good morning to you all. Welcome. I want us to understand what the Spirit of God is teaching us today. All right? Jesus was referring to the abominations that cause desolation in the book of Daniel. So let's go to Daniel chapter 11, verse 31. Daniel 11, verse 31. And the Bible tells us there, and arms shall stand on his part, and they shall pollute the sanctuary of strength and take away the daily sacrifices unto God, and they shall place the abomination that maketh desolate. We are going, sins and iniquities are going to take place in there that will cause the Spirit of God and God to depart. So there shall be desolation of the Spirit that gives life and sustains life. There shall be desolation of the God that is love and transmits his love to us. So it will be without love. I don't know if you understand what the Spirit of God is saying to us this morning. Sister Rose Harris, good morning, beloved. Thanks for joining us. All right? I want us to understand. And the arms shall stand on his part, and they shall pollute the sanctuary. They are removing worship to God. They are introducing worship to idols. Every and anything goes. We fail to remember that when the temple was built, it was dedicated, it was sanctified, set apart for holy use to God. We remember what happened to Belshazzar when he took the holy utensils out of storage placed there by his grandfather Nebuchadnezzar so he could party. He was destroyed that very night. When he did that, God's spirit departed. The presence of God departed. Ichabod. And Cyrus came and utterly destroyed Babylon. And the Medo-Persian kingdom was started. You see? When Eli's sons were doing all kind of wrong things in the temple, having sex with women, taking the tithe and doing what they wanted with it. God's spirit departed. They went to war and 30,000 Israelites died, and the Ark of the Covenant was taken by the Philistines. And when Hophni's wife, who was pregnant, heard, she gave birth to a boy instantly, and she called him Ichabod. The spirit of God had departed. Israel was desolate, and so destruction befell them. I want you to get what the Bible is a theme throughout the Bible. Judas walked with God, and Jesus reached out to him and reached out to him. But at the Last Supper, when Jesus looked him in the eye and says, "You are the man," he looked at Jesus like he didn't know what he was talking about. The Bible says Satan entered him because the Spirit of God left him. He became desolate. And so the destroyer took over. He went out and it was night, the Bible says, because now he had placed his allegiance with the prince of darkness. And he went out and hung himself. The theme is throughout the Bible. Daniel 12:11. "And from the time that the daily sacrifice shall be taken away, and the abomination that maketh desolate set up, there shall be 1,290 days. So we see the theme. Bad things are going to be done within the temple that will cause the spirit to leave and the enemy to come, and destruction will be the result. All right? Now in Daniel chapter 8 verse 14, we are told, and we, those of us who are Seventh-day Adventists, are very familiar with this. Sister Anne-Marie Brown and Brother Sammy, good morning. Blessings to you both. The Bible tells us there, "And he said unto me, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed." That sanctuary is referring to Jesus. I need you to get me here now, brethren. Everything in the Old Testament points to Christ. Christ is the anti-type. Everything is the type. All right? God gave Moses instructions. Moses did stuff to include build a sanctuary. The sanctuary pointed to Christ. Those people were coming out of Egypt. They didn't know their God. 400 years of slavery. If you're black, you're going to have an idea what I'm talking about. Because we was enslaved in a foreign land like the Jews were, and we have lost our identity. In 1950, all right, we were Negroes. In 1960s, we were blacks. In the 70s, we became African Americans. Every decade in the past, we changed in identity because we confused. You understand me? We lost a knowledge of our God. And all kinds of stuff began to happen to us. And after all that has transpired, although we claim to be free, we still see the effects of slavery in us and through us. So God, in his love for his people, had to reach them where they were. So he had Moses do stuff that would point to Jesus. The Ten Commandments pointed to the love of God and his compassion. I say over and over again, the Ten Commandments is not a legal document. It's a love document. It's God telling his children, don't go in the road and play. You're going to get hit by a truck and I'm going to hurt because you're going to lose your life. He's not doing it to punish. He's doing it because he loves and he wants to save. And the sanctuary pointed to Christ. The inner sanctum, or the most holy place, is his heart. And the holy place is the rest of his body. And the Bible makes it a very clear, and I'll bring the scripture at the end. You see? So, I want you to understand that when it says the sanctuary was going to be cleansed, at that period, it was talking about Jesus taking the sins of the world, going to Calvary, dying for those sins, and that body would go into the grave, and he'd come up the third day with a new body, like it's going to happen to us. The Bible tells us so. Matthew 26:36-46. Matthew 26:36-46. And the Bible tells us, "Then cometh Jesus unto them into a place called Gethsemane, and said unto his disciples, Excuse me, it's getting hot up in here. To God be the glory. All right? Sit ye here while I go pray yonder. And he took with him Peter, James, and John, the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Your sin was being placed upon him. My sin was being placed upon him. So he's beginning to get sorrowful because sin brings sorrow. Sin brings heaviness. It brings depression. It brings distress. It brings stress. And that's heavy. Then said he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. The wages of sin is death. He was beginning to feel the pangs of death drawing him to the grave. And he expresses it. And he went a little further. And he asked them to watch with him for a while. But they fell asleep. And he fell on his face and prayed, saying, in verse 39, oh, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. As he begins to have my crack smoking and the evil it brought through me and to me, he called on his Father and he says, I am perfect. This is not who I am. This is foreign to me. I know we planned before the foundation of the earth that if something bad or when something bad happened, I would come. It is one thing to be in glory with you before the foundation of the earth and say I'm going to come. But it's a whole different thing to be in the Garden of Gethsemane with Silburn sin on my back. I don't know if I can continue. But Father, not my will, but thy will be done. And when we find ourselves in acute situations, when we are hit hard by the enemy and we have the power, we don't have the power to fight, we gotta pray. Not my will, but thy will. And what happened with Jesus will happen with us. The Bible says, and he cometh unto the disciples and findeth them asleep and said to Peter, what, could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray. Watch and pray that he enter not. Watch and pray that he enter not into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak. So even if we want to do what's right, we don't have the power to do what's right because the flesh cannot empower us to do what's right. It's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. And Jesus is sharing that with us because he does not want those abominations that he took to Calvary to come back into our body temples. Because if they do, what will happen is that the enemy of our souls will take over and destroy us. I want to make it clear. He went away the second time, verse 42, and prayed, oh, my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. He surrendered. That's what we got to do. The Christian life is a life of surrender. Not my will. Not what I want. But I will serve you until you give me what is right for me. For they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall walk and not be weary. They shall run and not faint. Brethren, we got to learn to wait or serve God while we wait. Stand back and allow him to operate in our lives. Okay? And he came, verse 43, and found them sleeping again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away and prayed a third time, saying the same words. Then cometh him to his disciples and said unto them, sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand. And the Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that doth betray me. Now, I'll tell you, the Bible tells us in Luke and John that once Jesus prayed, an angel came and strengthened him. And when we pray for strength, earnestly, angels come and strengthen us. To God be the glory. So we see the sins of the world placed on Jesus. So the heavenly temple, the heavenly sanctuary, Jesus Christ, is polluted with your sin and mine. The perfect Lamb of God is no longer perfect. And the Bible tells us in Matthew 27, 45 to 50, all right? So much. Verse 45, now from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land unto the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? I need to let you know under the auspices of the Spirit that is speaking through me that God had not forsaken Jesus. He had forsaken the sins that were on him. So he turned his back. And for the first time in his history, in his existence, which always was, and the fact that he was always with the Father, because the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. For the first time, there was separation between Christ and the Father because of the sins upon him. God cannot behold sin. God cannot look upon sin. So even when his Son took our sins, God had to separate himself. And the Spirit began to separate himself, because it is a Spirit that gives life. It is a Spirit that sustains life. And he began to feel life ebbing out of his sin-polluted body. And the Bible tells us some of them that stood there, when they heard it, said, this man is calling for Elias. And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge, filled it with vinegar, and put it on a reed, and gave him to drink. The rest said, let be, let us see whether Elias could come and save him. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. The Spirit of life left him. The wages of sin is death. The penalty for sin was paid. And so now we have the unction of the Holy Spirit in us that will give us the power to live victoriously. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It is the Spirit of Christ living in my body temple that gives me the strength to overcome. Not by might, not by power. It is God that worketh in me to will and to do his good pleasure. The Christian life is a life of surrender to the Holy Spirit so that there can be no abominations in our body temple that will bring about our demise or our destruction. For those of you who are stuck on the fact that sanctuaries are built for God to dwell in by man, I want to take you to the book of Acts. The book of Acts. Acts chapter 17. Turn there with me. Well, let's go to Acts chapter 7 first. Acts chapter 7, let's read 48 and 49. Acts chapter 7, 48 and 49. Howbeit, the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands, as saith the prophet. Heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool. What house shall you build to me, saith the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? The purpose of the house on earth is to get you to know God, to point you to Christ, the divine sanctuary in heaven. I need you to get that. And no house you could build. I don't care how nice your church look. I don't care how you brag about it. It's going to be rubble one day. It's going to burn like a furnace. Okay? And let's go to chapter 17. Because the scripture is interpreting scripture. I'm giving you scripture. I'm connecting the dots with scripture, brethren. If it is in the Bible, we accept it. If it's not in the Bible, we categorically reject it. All right? So the Bible says in chapter 17, verse 24, let's read together. Verse 24, let's read together. God that made the worlds and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands. We're going to church today to fellowship, but God is waiting for you there. He comes in your heart. We bring God to the temple when we go, and some of us bring the enemy because we are desolate of the spirit and we cause confusion up in there. Y'all know what I'm talking about? So let's not deny it. Let's not pretend it don't exist. Okay? Let us get real and let the Spirit of God interpret his word and not lean onto our own understanding or our intellectual knowledge. This can only be given to us by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, not by the education of men. Let us put that into our intellectual spiritual pipes and smoke it and get a spiritual high. Okay? It continues. Neither is worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth. One blood. I don't care. Red, yellow, black, white. One blood. The blood of Jesus. I may be a calendar, but when I accepted Jesus, the blood of Jesus trumps the calendar blood. So my brothers and sisters in Christ are more family to me than the calendars who don't know Christ. We've got to know our identity. We've got to embrace our identity. And we've got to worship the one that created us in his image, his likeness. He has identified us as his. Too many of us got identity crises. Ah, Lord have mercy. Help us, Lord. Help us. Help us. Help us. So, we understand that God ain't dwelling in no building that you and I make with brick and mortar and wood and stone. He dwells in the creation that he made on the sixth day. Man, his children. That's it. The temple is a body temple. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Well, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 19 and 20. Let's go there first. Because I want to pound this home, brethren, with the abominations that cause desolation. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 19 and 20, know ye not that your body is a temple, a sanctuary of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and ye are not your own. He's not dwelling in your church. When you're going home, God has sit down in the rostrum the whole week waiting for you to come back on Wednesday and for you to come back on Saturday. You understand me? Yes, it is sanctified. Because when we come in there, we give glory to him. Sacrifices and oblations are risen to him. That has to continue. It's a lot of us, like Aristarchus Epiphanes, who come in there with our demons in us, and we pollute the oblations and the sacrifices. Come on now. A lot of people go to church today who belong to the synagogue of Satan, and they're going to pollute the temple and to cause the worship of God and the oblations to him to cease, because they are desolate of the Spirit of God that they were created to have dwell in them by deception. So this is to open our eyes to the facts of life, brethren, of truth. Okay? Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, 16. And this one makes it very clear. Look at the abomination of desolation in this passage of scripture. I want you to read the scripture with me, so and making the connection to the abominations that cause desolation. Verse 16 of 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Know ye not that you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If you are the temple of God and the Spirit of God dwells in you, you're good. You're great. You're blessed. You got eternal life. No one can touch you. God will open doors. Nobody can shut it. God will shut doors for you. Nobody can open it. And those that malign you and take you down, God will have the enemy's children come and worship at your feet. And he will keep you in the last days when trials and temptations and persecution come, because his Spirit is in you. Your temple is his, and you have returned it to him, and you have allowed his Spirit to dwell. Look at verse 17. But any person that defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. So when you begin to perform the acts we mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 9 to 11, or Romans chapter 1, 29 to 32, where we articulated the abominations. If we participate in that, the Spirit of God leaves. So your body becomes desolate. And that demon that possessed you before you met Jesus walks by and he sees his house clean. And he goes and he gets seven more demons worse than himself, possesses you, and Satan destroys you. It is the abominations that bring about the desolation of the Holy Spirit that causes Satan and his minions to take possession of the body temple and destroy it. Just like the temple was destroyed in Jerusalem. That's the type. You and I are the anti-type. Get it, brethren. Get it. Whew. These abominations that cause desolation in us are brought about through deception of the enemy. I'll tell you something. People say the mark of the beast is this and the mark of the beast is that. Brethren, the bottom line is the mark of the beast is deception. If you worship it on the wrong day, it's because you're deceived. If you can't forgive, it's because you're deceived. If you're stealing and you're lying, it's because you're deceived. All right? The Bible says, woe unto the inhabitants of the world. Woe unto the inhabitants of the earth. For the devil has come down with great wrath. He can't kill you. All he can do is deceive you. If Satan wants to kill me, sister, he has to deceive you to poison me. Satan, I can go and sleep in the cemetery for the rest of my life. He can't do nothing. Dead people can't do nothing. It's living. He can't deceive dead people. You see what I'm saying? Don't be afraid of him. He's a toothless tiger. He's not a roaring lion. He's like a roaring lion. That's a simile. You see what I'm saying? Sister Rose, if you come into your house, and I know you very well, my dear, Sister Rose Harris, and I hide in behind the door, you come home 11 o'clock at night, and I wait until you flick the lion and go, in a lion suit. You go box me down, because you know that's not a lion. New York not a lion. You go box me down, because I am like a roaring lion. I am not a roaring lion. Sometimes we need to box Satan down. You see? We got to expose him for who he is. He is a deceiver. And so many of us are deceived into sins and iniquities that will fall us when it comes to our soul salvation. All right? The Bible tells us in Revelation 13:4. Revelation 13:4. And I want to hustle it up. We have a few more scriptures here, and I want to get to them all. Revelation 13 and verse 4. And the Bible tells us, and they worshiped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast, who is able to make war with him? So I want us to focus. The dragon is the devil. You think I'm kidding you? Let's go to Revelation chapter 12. Let's go to Revelation chapter 12. All right? The Bible tells, okay, let's go from verse 10. I want to tell you, I've said to you, the dragon is the devil, so I want the Bible to tell us that. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of the brethren is cast down, which accused them before God night and day. He make you sin, then he go and tell God, look, you sinning. All right? Tattletale, pusillanimous, piece of garbage. That's what he is. And they overcame him, the devil, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe, however, unto the inhabitants of the earth and for the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth he has but a short time. And when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth, who was cast unto the earth? The devil was. He persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child. You understand me? So the Bible tells us that the devil and the dragon are one and the same. Okay? So the dragon now gives power to the beast. The beast represents governmental authority an ecclesiastical authority or church or religious authority. They're coming together right here in America. Marjorie Taylor Greene and the Speaker of the House want to marry church and state so it can become one power. I want you to understand what I'm saying here. And the problem is they're allowing Satan to direct them, so they're misquoting scripture. That's why they're kissing Trump's ring. Because the abominations that we see perpetuated by Donald Trump are clear for all to see. He's the father of lies, right under his father, the devil. And I say that on the authority of God's word. When a man could tell lies so much that he begin to believe they're the truth. Jesus says, you are of your father, the devil. He was a liar from the beginning. And when he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of himself. He is a liar and the father of it. And then he turned to the people who were lying and trying to kill him. And he said, you are of your father, the devil. Go read it in John 8 from 44 down. Go read it. Okay? So I ain't talking. I ain't judging. I look at fruit and I'm presenting what the fruit reveals. Okay? So, I want you to understand the marriage of church and state, ecclesiastical power and authority, and governmental, municipal power and authority. The Bible is telling us Satan is giving them power, those false religions, and the governmental power, the municipalities, coming together. To legislate morality. Next week we're talking about free will. And we will discuss that a little further when we talk about free will next week. Because God didn't legislate for Adam. He gave him free will. God had the power to stop him from sinning. He didn't. We can't legislate sin and then put people in jail. Now there are certain sins that you have to protect the world from, like murder and rape, incest. Also, yes, somebody does stuff like that. You got to keep them away so that we can protect society. But you can't run around being so moral, like you have never sinned, that you want to make a law for this and a law for that, so you can stop sinning and make. You can't make America righteous by legalizing morality. That's what I want to say. You see? But that's Satan's way. Satan is legalistic. God is love. Even his law that appears to be a legal document is not. It's a love document. Okay? So, the Bible tells us here that the dragon gives power to the beast. Let's keep reading. Revelation 13, 11 to 17. And I beheld another beast coming out of the earth, and had two horns like a lamb, and spake like a dragon. America, 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 bring me your lost, give me your persecuted, put up the Statue of Liberty, come, get liberty, everybody come, I come, you come, sis, everybody come. Now, it's phones here, they're tracking you everywhere you're going, and it's all kind of stuff being put up to curtail you. COVID come, they say take the vaccine. If you don't take the vaccine, they're firing you. If you don't take the vaccine, you can't this, you can't that. When you come to church, you got to move from there to here. You got, everything is legislated and we're not seeing it because it is sneaking up on us. And because we are so afraid to die, we will do what Satan say to live. But Satan can't give life. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. And you know, people don't like to say it, but I'm going to say it. COVID came and it exposed the so-called Christian church. Because we read Psalm 91, 1,000 shall fall at my right side and 10,000 at my left, but it shall not come nigh me. For he shall give his angels charge over me to keep me in all my ways. They will make sure that when I walk in, I don't stump my toe. I don't dash my foot against a stone. We say we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who came and reached out and touched the leper and vanquished leprosy. But we are saying today that COVID was more powerful, so we've got to run into hiding. We got to quarantine. And we're going to become bandits with masks on our face. and claiming we're having faith in Jesus. Somebody got to say it. I don't mind being unpopular, but I am just putting on to you what Jesus has put on my lips through his Spirit. Okay? He gave power to the government and the church to neutralize our faith in Jesus so he can fill us with abominations so the Spirit can leave. And that's how it happened, through deception. The Bible tells us so. In Revelation 13, verse 14, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying unto them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had a wound by a sword and did live. We know that papal Rome got a deadly wound when the Pope was arrested and thrown in prison, but that wound has since healed. It didn't kill papal Rome. It still exists today. It has come back with power, and it is the leading ecclesiastical authority in Christendom. Yes, the Muslim religion is bigger than the Christian religion, but the Christian religion has always been subject to the Catholic Church. Everyone has something from the Catholic Church. Simply elevating the platform for the pastor to preach. We got it from there. Jesus says the ground is level at the foot of the cross. The Catholic Church said no. The priest got to build it up higher. All of us build our temples, our physical temples, with a rise. Okay? Just giving you one little example. So, a lot of people like to bomb the Catholics. To thyself be true. Bomb yourself. Look in the mirror. Search me, O God. Know my heart. Try me. Know my thoughts. See if there be any wicked way in me. See if there's any abominations in me that will make my body temple desolate of your spirit, so the enemy can come and destroy me. So we see it is done by deception, brethren. Okay? So we've got to get into the word. All right? In Matthew 24, and I think it's 24. Matthew 24. He said, if it were possible, Jesus speaking. Matthew 24 and verse 24. For there shall arise false Christ and false prophets that shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, it's not possible, the very elect would be deceived. The very elect are not deceived, because thy word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We search these scriptures. We study these words. We're not reading nobody else's books. This. Make sure you got this down pat, then go read the books. Don't put the cart before the horse. Because his deception is powerful. Okay? I just want to make that abundantly clear. So where is Jesus now, brethren? Where is Jesus now? We're coming to a close. I got 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 scriptures if the Spirit put word on my lips. Turn with me to Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, the Bible tells us where Jesus is. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that is holding the seven candlesticks, the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou hast not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars. Jesus is somewhere. He has got seven stars in his right hand, and he is among the seven golden candlesticks. If you go back to Moses' temple, those were in the holy place. Okay? Go back to Revelation, to the Old Testament, when Moses talks about the sanctuary. In the sanctuary were the seven golden candlesticks with the lights burning. So Jesus is in the holy place trimming the lamps of the seven churches, you and I, to make sure that we are burning brightly. Okay? The Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 5, 14 to 16. All right? Like I say, scripture must interpret scripture. Matthew chapter 5, 13 to 16. Turn there with me quickly. And the Bible tells us, you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do a man light a candle and put it under a bushel, but onto a candlestick, and it giveth light into the whole house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. So Jesus is trimming your lamp so it can burn brightly, so that his light can shine into the dark places of the world, so those that belong to him can see the light and be drawn to it. Like a ship on a stormy night, we'll see the light of the lighthouse. Jesus is the lighthouse. To God be the glory. So, he is in the holy place. He's in the holy place. And the Bible tells us in Psalm 23, verse 6, for surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, all the days of your life, and we shall dwell in the holy place, in the house of the Lord, forever and ever and ever. Our body temples, which is the house of the Lord, will be clean. And the Spirit of God will dwell in us, and we in him. Galatians 2:20, for I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ living in me by his Spirit. His Spirit is in the holy place because this body was meant for him to dwell in. So the life I now live in this flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me so that the abominations that would cause my body to be desolate of him can be vanquished, so his Spirit can come in and dwell. So once I am in him and he is in me, I am in the holy place because Christ is the holy thing. Hebrews chapter 10. We have two more scriptures. And we're done. Hebrews chapter 10. And we read verse 16 and 17. After Jesus has delivered you, and he has gotten all the abominations out of you, he has made you a new creation, a new creature, he is going to do this. Because now he's in you, he can work from within. So this is what he's going to do. This is the covenant, the agreement I will make with you after those days. Now you're clean, you're washed. God is in you, so he will put his laws in your heart, in the most holy place. And he will write them in your minds so it can dictate what transpires in the holy place. All right? And your sins and your iniquities will I remember no more. And Ephesians chapter 3. 14 to 18, and we are done after that. Ephesians chapter 3, 14 to 18. For this cause, I bow my knees unto the Father, God the Father, of our Lord Jesus Christ. I worship him. Now the sacrifices and the oblations have returned. Hallelujah. Because this temple is clean and the Spirit of God is propelling me to worship God in spirit and in truth. John 4:24. All right? Of whom this whole family in heaven and earth is named, children of the living God, that he would grant me and you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. All right? In the body temple, inside of this thing here. All right? That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. Where is Christ? In the holy place in me. In the holy place in you. That's where he wants to dwell by his Spirit. All right? So, that we will be rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints. We'll get an understanding with the other saints of the word. All right? What is the breadth, the length, and the depth, and the height? and to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge. You can't understand his love. Don't try to figure it out. All right? That ye may be filled with the fullness of the God that is love. Brethren, God has spoken. Let the church say, amen. Heavenly Father, you have made it plain through the word. I thank you for Sister Thea and her ministry here at One Accord. She's going to have all those scriptures in the thread. It is my prayer that those who are here today and those who will watch subsequently will copy and paste to their WhatsApp or to their messages and go back in their closets in a quiet time, calling on your spirit to guide them and teach them and direct them into your truth so they can understand what Jesus meant when he said, when you see the abominations that bring about desolation, go stand in the holy place. Be in Christ and ensure Christ is in us so that no matter what transpires out there, you will keep us from falling and you will be faithful to protect us from the wiles of the enemy. Help us not to get caught up in historical data. Help us not to get caught up in arithmetic, but help us to be caught up in love. The love of God that is greater far than pen or tongue can ever tell. Help us to be your true apostles and disciples by loving one another, because it is by this that everybody will know that we are yours and that you are ours when we show love one for another. We thank you for this word. We thank you for your love. Now be with us as we go through the rest of this day. May we worship you in spirit and in truth. And for those who are not worshipers on Sabbath, may they have a wonderful day contemplating what they heard today, meditating on your word, so it may become clear to them, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen and amen. To God be the glory. We thank you for your thing. So we're going to call on my dear sister to sing a closing song, after which I will give the greeting to those of you who are on here with us today.
Amen, amen. Such a powerful sermon that Elder Callender has presented. And as I sing this song, I would like us to meditate on the words. And please put a prayer in your heart. Say a prayer in your heart for me as I sing. So, thank you. You have long for sweet peace and for faith to increase, and have earnestly, fervently prayed. But you cannot have rest nor be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid. Amen. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart, does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and of peace and sweet rest as you healed him, your body and soul. Would you walk with the Lord in the light of his word and have peace and contentment always? You must do his sweet will to be
altar, you're all you must lay. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control. You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield him your body and soul. Oh, church is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid. Your heart does the Spirit control. Oh, you can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield him your body and soul. You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield him your body and soul. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Okay. So we're going to greet you and bid you goodbye at this time, and we will just play a closing rendition that will enable us to do that. I cannot access all my YouTube. I cannot access all my YouTube, my Facebook people today because I lost the phone. But I did see Brother Peter Noel. Thank you, Peter, for joining us. Blessings to you and your family. Okay, let's give it some volume.
How we live, Jesus. How we live, Jesus.
Brother Peter Noel, welcome. Thanks for joining us.
It's
Sister Clarette Gabriel Lewis, God bless you. Thanks for joining us. Sister Claudia Brett, thanks for joining us. Sister Vanessa Louison, God bless you. In St. Lucia, soon to be in New York, thanks for joining us. Sister Lucretia Emilier, thanks for joining us, sister. God bless you. Sister Avon Carr, thanks for joining us. Sister Lianolin Palagnog from the Philippines, thanks for joining us. Sister Janet Janice Niles, thanks for joining us. And Brother Alan Samuel, I know there were a lot more of you. Sister Esther St. Louis, Brother Julius, Brother Sugarman, Brother Alexander Boyton, thanks for joining us. Sister Anne-Marie Florentville, thanks for joining us. You, your daughters, and your niece, thanks for joining us. Sister Carmela Peters, Sister Farah Duplessis, Sister Lilia Joseph, thanks for joining us. Sister Chris King David, down there in Maryland, thanks for joining us. Blessings to you. Now on YouTube, Sister Camelia Arthur, thanks for joining us. God bless you. Sister Brenda Samuel, God bless you, Brother Simba. Thanks for joining us. Sister Avon Carr, God bless you. Thanks for joining us. Dr. Cedric Hines and your family down there in Atlanta, Georgia. Thanks for joining us. Brother Garnet Patron, thanks for joining us, your wife and your family. Sister Veronica Qualls, Brother Wayne, and the entire Qualls family. God bless you all. Thanks for joining us. Sister Karen Dewsbury, Brother Dewsbury, thanks for joining us. Sister Angela Mahu, God bless you. Brother Garcia Jumont, Sister Pat, and family, much love to you guys. God bless you. there were quite a few more, but I kind of missed out. Sister Kathleen Martinez. Liz, thanks for joining us, beloved. Him of his
garment,
and his love
made me whole. His blood made me whole.
Amen.
I said his blood made me whole.
It is. God bless you.
Yes,
God keep you. May God's face continue to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may He give you peace and love to receive and to share is my prayer for us.
Jesus.